this is my Bible. It is the living word of God. My mind is renewed and my spirit is prepared to receive the word which produces faith. And faith pleases God. I'm not just a hearer, I'm a doer. This word has given me life and life more abundantly. Amen. Hallelujah. If you would remain standing, go to Matthew chapter 5, Matthew 5, verse 3. Anybody need to hear from God tonight? Amen. Good. You're going to hear from him. Amen. Matthew 5, verse number 3. When you have it, say amen. Hallelujah. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Isn't it amazing how God says, in the middle of your mess, that's when you're the most blessed. Y'all ain't talking to me tonight. Blessed are those who mourn, they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Meek there doesn't mean weak. It just means humble. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be what? Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain. So if you don't get nobody mercy, the Bible says you ain't going to get none. Tell somebody, say, have mercy with me. Don't have mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. In other words, God says, if you serve me for other motives, you ain't going to see me. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. Anybody been lied on? Anybody ever had somebody tell them, you know, have folks talk about you and say stuff, and they knew it wasn't true? And look what the Bible says, verse 12. Go and read it. No. Y'all ain't got it. Blessed are you when they revile you and persecute you and say evil stuff about you. So look at verse 12. This is 12. 12 says this is how you respond. Rejoice. So in other words, in the middle of the worst hell of my life, that's when you see me praising God the most. I don't wait until times get good. I feel like preaching tonight. Right in the middle of my hell, rejoice and be exceeded. Y'all, all right. For great is your reward in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were set before you. Watch this. This is why you got to rejoice. Watch this. Because you are the salt of the earth. Look at somebody's touch them, say, you salt. But if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it, talking about the earth, be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown and trampled underfoot by men. God says, your Christianity, if you ain't salty when it's hard, then your Christianity ain't worth nothing. God says, if you're not pressing when it gets hard, your Christianity ain't worth it. Anybody been going through some stuff and you've been having to press and endure? God says, that makes your Christianity worth something. So now watch this. Watch this. You are the light of the world. Coincidental, we're here in Denver, which is a city on a hill. Uh-huh. A city that's set on a hill that cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand. In other words, God says, you can be going through stuff, and God says, I'm going to put you on display when you're going through stuff so that other folks can see your light and they'll be able to know they can make it through too. There's some pain, God says, I put that pain on display so that other folk will be able to see it because they got to be able to see your light. Y'all ain't hearing what I'm... So some of you have been wondering, why I got to go through this, and why is this happening, and why? Because God says, I need other folks to see you go through it and see you make it. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Tell somebody, say, they need to see you make it. I feel like preaching tonight. So watch this. It says, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to everybody in the house. So what's the house he's talking about here? He's talking about the earth. Let your light so shine before mine. Look at somebody say, this little light of mine. I'm going to let it shine. That they may see your good works. Better word there is fruit. and glorify your Father in heaven. Do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I didn't come to destroy it, but to fulfill it. For surely I say to you, heaven and earth shall pass away, and not one jot or tittle shall no means pass away from the law. That word better there is word. Till it's all fulfilled. I'm going to go back up to one verse, 13. You are the salt of the earth. This ain't just to your neighbor. This is to you. Mm-hmm. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt loses its flavor, how shall the earth be seasoned? Father, I decrease the too many increase. Speak now. Father, give us deliverance. We open our ears to hear you. We open our eyes to see you in Jesus' name. Somebody shout amen. Amen. Just slap a neighbor, high five. Say, neighbor, holy living 101. You can be seated tonight. Hallelujah. As I begin to teach tonight, say it. Say, I am the soul of the earth. Please understand, the problem with most saints is that they get saved and they get so excited that they're not going to hell and they've got their fire insurance that they do not realize nor do they understand the purpose of their salvation. Your salvation is not just so you can come and have saved people meetings. You're not hearing what I'm saying. Your salvation is not just so that you can say, I got my ticket to the midnight train and I'm getting on the train. Some of y'all know what I'm talking about. That's the old school church. He said, I got my ticket, and when he comes calling my name, I'm going to be ready to answer. And the problem is so many saints are so ready to die that they never live. Everybody's ready to cross over the River Jordan, but ain't nobody lived on the other side of the river. Y'all ain't saying nothing tonight. You are the salt of the earth. Are you here? So watch this. God's purpose in salvation. I taught you on Sunday. We are blessed. You understand that? You understand? So if we are blessed, God says, go to 1 Samuel 12:22. We're going to build this tonight. I need y'all to come with me. I need y'all to run with me. Y'all running? 1 Samuel 12:22. Now watch this. God says, I save you. And one of the reasons I save you is so that you could demonstrate the blessing in the earth. You need to hear what I'm saying. God says, I need folk to see you blessed. You're not hearing what I'm saying. God says, I need folk to see you do well. I need folk to see you prosper. I need folk to see you have somebody shoot you wrong and you still do right by them. I need folk to see you go through hell and come out licking an ice cream cone. I need folk to see you to demonstrate the blessing. You have no appreciation for the blessing until you've walked the day in the curse. Anybody done some curse stuff and you didn't put, anybody ever chose the curse? You have no appreciation for walking in, I feel like preaching tonight, except that you first seen a curse. You don't understand good until you've seen bad. You don't understand prosperous until you've seen poverty. So God says, I saved you so you could demonstrate the blessing in the earth. Folk need to see it. And some Jesus, the only people Jesus, some folk won't see is you. And for some folk, the only Christ they're going to see is you. And they need to see how you handle your Calvary. See, somebody keeps thinking that it's your issues that disqualify you. And I need to remind you, it's your stuff and it's your hell that actually qualifies you. Jesus wasn't Christ Jesus until he conquered death, hell, and the grave. He was just a man until they saw God work through him as Christ Jesus. And when he conquered the grave, somebody said, now I can follow him because he went through hell and he got up. Y'all ain't talking to me. So 1 Samuel 12:22, watch this. For the Lord will not forsake his folk. Watch this. For his name's sake. God says, I chose you to demonstrate the blessing. And God says, it ain't that you so good that I do it. He says, it's for my name's sake. Because I don't want folk talking about me like I can't provide for my people. You're not hearing what I'm saying. Some of the stuff God has done for you had nothing to do with you. It wasn't your prayer. It wasn't your fasting. It wasn't your offering. It wasn't none of you. God said, I did it for my name's sake. I didn't want nobody to think I was a deadbeat dad. And so I had to show them the blessing working in the earth. So now watch this. Because it pleased him to make you his people. You go to the New Testament, it talks about as they're writing, and Peter's writing his books, he says, now to the people of the dispersion, to the lost tribes of the house of Israel, the Gentile people, he says, you were once a people without a name, without a nation. You had no heritage. You didn't know who you were. You didn't know where you came from. You didn't know what was in you. And God says, I gave you an identity. Please understand, if you were ever an orphan child who had no one that wanted to claim you, that's what you were before you were saved. God says you were an orphan. Devil didn't even want to claim you. And God says, when you stepped into salvation, God says, I adopted you and made you my people, and it was good for me that I did that. Okay? All right? Watch this. Go to Psalm 106:8. Psalm 106:8. Say, demonstrate the blessing. I feel this thing. I feel this all in my sanctified. So what's this? Psalm 106:8. When you have it, say amen. So God saved you so you could demonstrate the blessing in the earth. Do you understand that? People on earth need to see the blessing. You didn't hear what I said? People on earth need to see the blessing. Watch this. Nevertheless, he what? Huh? He saved them. Why? For his name's sake. God says, you ain't going to have me looking toe up. God says, I provided for you because that's what Abram said I am. He said, I am Yahweh Jireh. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord, your provider. God says, I've done a lot of stuff for you for my name's sake. Tell somebody and say, for my name's sake. Now watch this. That he might make his mighty power known. Watch this. Look at somebody and say, make his power known. Now watch this. He rebuked the Red Sea also, and it dried up, so he led them through the depths as through the wilderness. He saved them from the hand of him who hated him and redeemed them from the hands of the enemy. The waters covered their enemies. There was not one of them left. No, you missed it. Now, what is he giving you a recount of? He's giving you a recount now of the children of Israel. And God is saying, I did all of that for them for my name's sake, because I didn't want Pharaoh to think he let them go. No, you miss it. I didn't want Pharaoh to get an. I didn't want him. See, I didn't want your boss to think they gave you the promotion. So that's why I skipped around the system and I made them fire you. And I met because I didn't want nobody else to. I didn't want your ex to think it was their little $500 a month spousal support. That's. I didn't want them to think that. Y'all ain't talking to me. I didn't want them to think it was them that did it. So God says, I'll put you in some circumstances where the blessing's got to manifest. And baby, the blessing manifests best right in the middle of a cursed situation. You're not hearing what I'm saying. The blessing manifests best right in the middle of hell. Go to Psalm 31:3. Psalm 31:3. Come on, I got to build this. Clock say I got a few minutes. Come on. Psalm 31:3. Do you have it? Watch this. When you have it, say amen. For you are my rock and my fortress. Therefore, what? Lead me and guide me. The psalmist is saying, God, so that you don't look bad, please guide me. Because I'm liable to walk right into a ditch because, you know, I sometimes be acting like I can't see what's right in front of me. I sometimes be acting like I didn't hear what the man of God said. I sometimes be acting like I don't know what the word says. So God, even with my eyes closed, why don't you lead me for your name's sake now? So he says, I saved you so you could demonstrate the blessing in the earth. Watch this. Tell somebody, say, he's going somewhere. We are not just born. We are born again. No. You didn't hear what I said. We are not just born. We are born again. No. They ain't got it. We are not born once. We are born. Go to Galatians 4. Go to Galatians 4. Let me help you. Because see, some of y'all don't understand where you're at in process of your journey. Let me help you. Help your neighbor. What's this? In other words, I'm not Adam that happens to go to church. I'm not an Adam with a suit on. I'm not an Adam with a collar on. I'm not an Adam that knows a little Shokubai and how to hire Mitsubishi Subaru Honda. I'm not an Adam that just puts on a good show. I am born again, which means Christ is being formed in me. The problem with most saints is that they never really got born again. They just dressed Adam up. Oh, okay. All right, well, what's this? Say, Christ is being formed in me. Watch this, Galatians 4, 18 through 19. Watch this. Watch this. But it is good to be zealous in a good thing when? Always, and not only when I am with you. So Paul is saying that y'all know how to act saved around. You know how to be real spiritual around. You know how to quote all the stuff the preacher said. But Paul said, I need you to understand that if you just do it in front of me, your salvation, your salt is worthless. Because you know what that is? That's witchcraft. Y'all ain't gonna say nothing because it's manipulation. I want people to think I'm super saved, so let me say all the saved stuff when I'm in front of them. But when I go home, I'm really a hoe. When I go home, y'all ain't saying nothing. I really act like I don't have no sense, so let me act like it. And folk don't understand that Christ is being say born again. Born again means I'm not rehabilitating Adam. I killed him and started over. I need you to get it. I'm not rehabilitating a wacko. I'm starting over. Now, here's the deal. Here's the deal. Read verse 19. My little children, watch this. He's telling them where they're at in terms of where Christ is being formed in them. He's saying, y'all haven't matured in anything yet, Galatians. No. He's saying, y'all are little kids for whom I labor in birth. Watch this again. Until Christ is formed in you. So Paul is saying, he's saying, y'all said the Jesus prayer, but y'all turned back to bondage. So Paul is saying, all of that born again that happened, you step right back into Adam. So he's saying, I got to labor again now to have you reborn. Because Christ was never formed in you. You never stopped going to the places you used to go. You never stopped hanging with the folk you used. You never changed nothing. You just dressed up Adam. Nothing ever changed. You just started coming to church. You just put a suit on it and said it was good. But you didn't actually change nothing. So Paul is saying, I got to rebirth you. But isn't it good to know God will let you have a do-over?
I said, isn't it good to know that God says, my mercy endureth forever. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. That's all right if I got to be rebirthed because I get a do-over.
Tell somebody, say, you get a do-over. Now watch this, watch this, watch this. Because this ain't judgment. This is so that we understand where we're at. When you're born, you start as a baby. You don't come out the womb speaking in tongue. You don't. Well, actually, it may sound like tongues. Watch this. You don't come out the womb walking. Matter of fact, you probably can't even crawl too good. Reason some saints get discouraged in their walk is because they're coming out of the birth canal trying to be like somebody that's matured. So they think less of themselves, but they don't realize they're a baby. And they're trying to look at their 17-year-old brother comparing themselves, and they're not equal. And so if I judge my walk with God based on, watch this, the next level, which is that of an adolescent, I'll be discouraged because, see, they out riding bikes. And I'm in the house sucking a bottle. Good God, I wish somebody would help me tonight. They are having fun and having playtime and going to the video game and going to the show. And I'm stuck in the house on a bottle. They know how to handle some of those old relationships. And I'm stuck in isolation. Because I don't know how to deal with that yet. Y'all ain't saying nothing. See, Christ, say Christ, is being formed in me. So then you have an adult. You have a fully developed being in Christ. Please understand, you can be 70 naturally and 4 spiritually. Please understand, that's why whenever God was ready to do something in the Bible, he always got the younger generation to do it. He said, let's get rid of them ones of 21, let me start over. When he wanted to choose apostles, what you don't know is those apostles were aged 13 to 21. That's what you don't know. God says, I want to use some young folk to do it. He said, because I need folk that don't think they know it all. I don't need somebody that's going to sit up and try to tell the preacher how to preach because they don't even know what they're talking about. They know false scriptures trying to critique the preacher. You don't know enough to critique nothing. The disciple is not above the teacher. Watch this. He says, a baby, an adolescent, then you have an adult. Here's the deal. An adult, what do they get to do? They get to drive stuff. What does that mean? They get to lead stuff. You see? They're developed. They're not still wet in the bed. And expecting their mama to clean it up. They ain't wet in the bed and saying, Bishop! Comest thou and cleaneth. If they do have an accident, they know how to get depends because they know they need an adult diaper. Come on, sometimes you got to graduate from Huggies. Come on, somebody. So y'all so spiritual, y'all. What's this? Then you have a senior, which means they've matured into the faith, to the place where God can trust them now to help mature others. So you have a baby, an adolescent, an adult, a senior. Now, the deal is you decide how quickly you mature through those levels. A baby, when they don't get what they want, they cry. God, you had told me. I gotta fight all the time. Lord, I am so tired of fighting. I'm just. But don't be judged by that because that's where you're at in your growth. Amen. Now, when you get to the adolescent stage, they, you know, they cry, but, you know, they can't cry in front of mom and daddy. Them, you know, they'll, you know, 13, give me my, you know, get my privacy, you know. Yes, sir. The problem with adolescents is they have attitude problems. You can always tell an adolescent saint because they got an attitude problem. They won't smile, they won't clap, they won't say nothing nice to nobody, and if you don't do them right, they're going to let you know. That's let you know that they're an adolescent spiritually. Attitude problems, you know, they got hormonal. And then you have an adult. See, an adult, they're supposed to be able to control their emotions. They're supposed to be able to say, you know what, I could react this way, but I choose not to because I'm mature. So even though I want to let her know where to get off, how to get there, and all the directions in between, I'm an adult, so I choose not to. Deuteronomy 11:26, see this day I have set before you the blessing and the curse. Choose! And you have a senior. Watch this. Christ is always being formed in you. Let me help somebody. You're never going to arrive. Let me help you, because you know, a lot of saints think they arrived to this high level of spirituality to now where everybody else is Pharisee and Sadducee and all that. I've been in the way for 17 years, and that's the problem. You've been in the way that whole time. Y'all know folk like that. I've been serving the Lord, me and Peter and Paul, and we walk the earth together. And you still immature. Say, so I decide how quickly Christ forms. Watch this. So, but let me just help you. Don't ever think you're going to get to a place to where you arrive, to where you're just going to be walking in the third heaven all day. You're just floating. No, if you do that, that's weird. That ain't spiritual. That's just weird. Tell somebody, say weird. Say, Christ is being formed in me. Now go to Luke 14. Luke 14. I'm about through. Luke 14. I need you to get this, because we're talking about the topic tonight is holy living 101. And a lot of folk don't understand what holiness is all about, because, you know, people think holiness is all this stuff that deals with stuff that doesn't have Christ actually form in you. So we know how to dress up Adam, but we never actually killed him. And that's what a lot of people think holiness is. That's why you can meet a saint and see him, and then, but don't see him out in the grocery store when their kid's acting up. Because all of that saint ain't. Because if it's really me, it's me here, it's me there, it's me everywhere. But that's your neighbor. Say, don't be discouraged. Christ is being formed. So that's all right. If you still got some issues because you're in treatment, that's all right. That's what I'm going to say. That's all right. You know, you just mature out of that. See, there's some stuff, even let me help the parents. There's some stuff you keep trying to rebuke and bind and all that, and your kids, they just need to mature out of it. And you're thinking it's the end of the world, and you're calling Dr. Phil, Dr. Seuss, and all the rest. And you just need to let them mature out of some stuff. There's some relationships they'll just mature out of. Matter of fact, there's some relationships you'll just mature out of. Because when you start to mature in Christ, you'll realize, wait a minute, this ain't going nowhere. It ain't hitting on nothing. Ain't never been hitting on nothing. I don't know why I've been spending my time, because I've matured beyond that. Watch this. Luke 4, 18. Are you there? Luke 4 and 18. Watch this. Say, so my original question was, why did God save you? Number one was to demonstrate the blessing in the earth. Number two, that you might be the salt of the earth. Watch this. Luke 4 and 18. Watch this. Am I helping anybody? And all those, ain't it. I'm making sure y'all in the spirit. Watch this. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to who? The poor.
Now, why would he want to preach to the gospel to the poor? So he'd tell them, you ain't got to be poor no more. That's why. Not just monetarily, but you ain't got to be bankrupt spiritually. Some folk are walking corpses. There's no life. Because the trials and the issues of life have choked all of their zeal and their passion. And so they just exist now. Can somebody say, not me?
Not me.
Watch this. Watch this. He has sent me to... Huh? To proclaim liberty to the captives. See, well folk don't need a doctor. Sick folk don't need a doctor. Wholehearted folk don't need to be preached to about getting the whole heart. You understand? To proclaim liberty to the captives. Watch this. Recovery of sight to the blind. Folk that can see don't need to be preached to about seeing. Well, I says, to set at liberty those who are what? Oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable or the chosen year of the Lord. Now, watch this. Let me help your neighbor understand something. This scripture ain't just talking about Jesus. It ain't just talking about Isaiah. It's talking about you. The Spirit of the Lord is upon you because he's anointed you to preach the gospel. You know how you preach the gospel? When somebody sees you go through a bankruptcy and you come out with your head up. You know how you preach the gospel? When you lose 2, 3, 4, 5 houses and you still got to put. You know how you preach the gospel? Once you done been through 4, 5 divorces and you still dating. Y'all ain't saying nothing. He's anointed me to preach the gospel, and I preach it through living it. Nobody cares if you can see and you always could see. Nobody cares. But they do care if once you were blind. But now. So I'm anointed to preach the gospel. Look at what God says. Now, this is talking about you now. He says, well, but let me just back up real quick. Can I back up? Let me just back up. Because he has anointed me. What does that mean? How you get the oil out of the olive? I wish I had a church in this place tonight. God says, you know what I did to anoint you? To really anoint you. See, your anointing wouldn't mean nothing unless you've been through something. See, I don't know about you, but I don't want nobody trying to tell me about something and they ain't been through nothing. If you ain't been through some stuff, you can take your seat because ain't no anointing on you. You may have a sermon, but you don't have a rhema word from God. But when you done been through some stuff, you've been anointed to preach the gospel. High five somebody, say, I'm anointed. To proclaim liberty to the captives. recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who oppress. So here's what God does. God says, when I save you, there's stuff that you've endured and you will endure that's going to give you keys to some stuff. You're not hearing what I'm saying. The only way Christ got keys to death, hell, and the grave is he had to go there. You're not hearing what I'm saying. God says, I'm giving you the keys to let some other folk out, but here's the catch. You got to go there. And some of you have been wondering, God, why do I have to go through this, and why I go through this, and why I go through this, and why this, and why this? God says, I was giving you some keys so you could go get some other folks out. Y'all ain't going to say nothing to me tonight. To proclaim the acceptable or the chosen year of the Lord. Please understand, we used to say in the church, you know, this is my year. This is my... Every year is my year since I got the blessing. You're not hearing what I'm saying. It ain't just going to be divine and 9 and divine and 9 and we win and 10, heaven and 11. Every year is the acceptable year of the Lord since I'm in Christ. So even if I think it was a bad year, that was just a year to get some anointing. That, y'all ain't hearing me. That was a year to get some crushing. And what that year does is it prepares me for the next year where I go to unlock somebody else's prison.
Jesus. I wish somebody would hear me. Watch this. Say, I am the soul of the earth. Now watch this. I like preaching like this. This is fun. Watch this now. Here's what you need to understand about salt. Say, I'm salt. In fact, I guarantee you, if you no, don't do it now. But on your way home, if you, it's going to be salty. See, God wanted to remind you every time. For those of you that be chewing your nails and stuff, don't be playing. You know it's salty. Bishop, how you know? Somebody told me. Watch it. Salt changes the boiling point of water. You understand? You put salt in water so that it raises the boiling point. You understand? I believe, and don't quote me on this, but I believe it. I believe water is supposed to boil at 212 normally. Is that 212 degrees normally? That's when water is supposed to boil. But when you put salt in there, it raises that boiling point. So what used to get it hot won't get it hot anymore. See, since I'm the salt of the earth, there's some stuff that used to upset me that don't even faze me no more. Do what you gotta do, player, because I'm gonna be all right. I'm salt, so that don't even get me hot no more. I used to want to go crazy, but I don't do that no more. I used to want to knock somebody out, but my boiling point has been raised. Here's the other deal. Watch this. Salt also changes the freezing point. Since I'm the salt of the earth, I'm not no one-hit wonder with God. Meaning, I don't get cold after not seeing results for a couple of weeks. You don't hear me? Meaning, I don't get cold because I had to endure some stuff. Because I'm salt. So 32 degrees Celsius should freeze the water, but not when salt's in there. When salt in there, it's got to get a lot colder before that's going to phase me. So listen, I made up my mind. Since I'm salt, I ain't leaving God. I ain't leaving church. Listen, you can do what you want to do. Though they slay me, yet will I trust him. Because I'm salt, so I don't get as hot as I used to, and you can't get me to get cold. I won't let church folks steal my heat. I won't let naysayers steal my heat. You may not like the way I praise. You may not like the way I shout. Baby, there's another seating section in the sanctuary. Because you're not going to get me to be cold. If you knew the hell I had to go through to get this far, you'd be shouting and acting crazy like me too. Baby, I am anointed to preach the gospel. Tell somebody, say, I'm anointed. Watch this. Watch this. Salt changes. I told you I felt like preaching. Salt changes the flavor of things. Especially here in Denver where they cook stuff in water. I promise you, my Popeye's chicken was fried in water. Still trying to figure out how they got their crust on there. Watch this. When I put salt on something, I'm saying there's not enough flavor to it. Salt changes the flavor, which raises sodium levels. Watch this. Which raises the pressure of one's blood. Yeah. Jesus, I wish I had a church. See, they shout about this in Green Valley. They shout about this. May 31st. All right, watch this. Let me parenthetically insert. We're starting a Sunday night live service in Green Valley Ranch on May 31st. Hallelujah. So we're coming. That's confirmed, right? Okay, watch this. If it ain't, we'll fix it. Watch this. Because he's anointed me to preach the gospel. So I'm not going to box myself into no city, into no building. Salt changes the flavor. It can raise the pressure. What's this? God says, when you get around folk, if you're salt, you ought to be flavoring the atmosphere. Please understand, if you cook something with no salt on it, you can taste the difference between that and stuff with salt on it. Matter of fact, if you like me and you can't get all creative with your seasonings and all that because you just want it to be edible, you got four seasons you put on everything. Pepper, garlic salt, seasoned salt, and this other little special blend of stuff I can't tell you about. Watch this. What the salt does is it takes something that was bland, without flavor. Watch this. It takes something, watch this, without taste. And what is taste? Taste gives something identity. I know fish from beef because it tastes different. I know chicken from fish because it tastes different. So God says, if you're the salt, you ought to make atmospheres taste different when you're there. You ought to be able to walk in and raise the pressure in an environment to where people say, listen, if you're going to be around, I'm going to have to get saved because you just changed the environment. So your friends shouldn't be able to cuss around you because you're salty. Throw salt on a wound. Somebody say, I'm the salt of the earth. Now, we read in our text, Matthew 5, we read that the Bible says, Jesus said, if the salt loses its flavor, how can it, the world, be seasoned? So if the church looks no different than the world, how is it the world is going to be seasoned? If we respond to trouble the same way they do, the world, how is it they're going to want to be salty? Because it doesn't seem there's any flavor there. Tell somebody, say, he's going somewhere. Say, I am salt. Salt, I told you, it raises the temperature, raises the boiling point. In other words, here's what salt does. Salt acts as a thermostat to change the climate of environments. See, that's the reason why some folk, when you come around, everybody, they start being quiet and all that. Because the environment just shifted. And you're trying to figure out why so-and-so don't like me. Because you're salty. And I used to be real tight with so-and-so, and they won't even call me no more. Because you're salty now. You're not hearing me. And so-and-so, I used to run with so-and-so, and so, and we used to do this. We used to go to the mall, and we used to do it. I mean, we caught the sales and everything. You're salty now. And as you mature, come on, connect the dots, class. Baby. Adolescent, adult, senior, as you mature, your salt content, which is Christ, increases. Are you hearing me? And as your salt content increases, it changes the things that you have desires for. Are you hearing me? Watch this. Tell somebody, say, he's going somewhere. I want to ask you a question. Are you really saved? Does your life look like you've met God? Go to 1 John 3:9. 1 John 3:9. This ain't judgment. I'm going to help you tonight. I feel like preaching tonight. 1 John 3:9. When you get there, say amen. I'm going to help us tonight. Woo! What I got 15 minutes. All right, come on, we got to go with y'all. We got to move. Come on, we got to ride. Here we go. 1 John 3:9, you ready? No one born or begotten, now this is amplified I'm reading, or begotten of God. Now remember, we are born a, first time we were born of a woman. Now we're born of God. First time was natural. The second is spiritual. Watch this. Deliberately, knowingly, and habitually practices missing the mark. Remember, I taught you last week, sin means to. So if I'm born again, I don't deliberately, knowingly, and habitually miss the mark. Because salt, this is the Bishop Foreman version, it says, for God's nature abides in him. Or salt abides in him. Here's what it says. His principal life, watch this, the divine sperm of God, just amplified, remains permanently within him. Oh, you're not hearing me. God says, when I'm formed in you, I interject you with my sperm. This is what your amplified Bible says. Don't tell somebody, don't be calling God. But that. And he cannot practice missing the mark or sinning because he's born again. Does somebody say he's going somewhere? Meaning, since God did all of this for me for his name's sake, how about I change some stuff about myself for his name's sake? I may not want to stop cussing folk out because it may make me feel good. Oh, don't play with it. I know you don't do it, but your neighbor that used to sit next to you at your old church was a cusser. Bless God. But since he did all of that for his name's sake, since his divine sperm rested in me, I don't do it because I don't want to. I don't do it for him. Because Christ is being in me. Let me take it another further? So, since his divine sperm is in me, please understand, he's interjected in me. He's given me his life. No longer I that live, but Christ that lives in me. His divine sperm is in me and it's being formed day after day. And here's, let me just interject this. Please understand, whatever you feed will grow. And so if you're constantly feeding Adam's nature, that's why he grows. The reason you feel like cussing so many folk out and acting crazy with folk is because you got 107.5 pumping all day in your ear talking about it ain't hurting you. And please understand, I'm not judging if you do that. What I'm saying is whatever you're feeding is going to grow. Let me deal with this one. Let me deal with lust. Tell somebody, say, he ain't judging nobody. I ain't judging nobody. So let's deal with lust. You know, you see, you know, six pack, six figure, 6 foot. See, but watch out all them sixes. Y'all ain't talking. But watch out for all, that's too many sixes. You tell them, listen, brother, if you were a little taller, we could, if you're a little shorter, but too many sixes. You got too many sixes. This thing is not going to work. It's in the Word. It's in the Bible. If I constantly let my head go, I'm feeding my lust. Y'all are not saying nothing. It got real quiet. Y'all was shouting and jumping up and getting in the camera shouting all that. If I constantly let my head. And then you check to make sure nobody saw you. Don't play with it. You know what my thing to the body of Christ, you know what I'm supposed to do to the body? What my job to the body is to make this understandable, number one. Number two, to make it real. That's my assignment to the body. And so please understand, you know, I know y'all have never done that. But you know people you need to be praying for to do that. People you need to be praying for, not you. 1 John 5:18, amplified. Here's what it says. 1 John 5:18. Are you with me? Go. We know absolutely that anyone born of God does not deliberately and knowingly practice committing sin. But the one who is begotten of God carefully watches over and protects him. Christ's divine presence within him preserves evil against him. And the wicked one does not lay hold or get a grip on him or touch him. Listen to it again. 1 John 5:18 is amplified. We know absolutely that anyone born of God does not deliberately and knowingly practice committing sin. Missing the mark. I'm 1 John 5:18. Watch this. But the one who was begotten of God, say, I'm begotten of God, carefully watches over and protects him. Well, what is him? Christ's divine presence within him, which preserves him against the evil and the wicked one, does not lay hold or get a grip of him or touch him. What does that mean? Say, I'm salt. Since I'm born again, I protect my salt at all costs. That's what the Bible says. Don't let your good be evil spoken of. Don't live above reproach. So it flee the very appearance of sin. Okay. Now, listen, why are you dealing with this? I dealt with conquering sin last week and all that. And then this week we're dealing with this principle because I'm setting us up because a lot of the times it's not we're doing so much what's wrong. It's we're not doing what's right. But many don't know what to do that's right. Because here's the deal. You got to have a replacement. See, if you're addicted to drinking Coke, remember, I think I told Bible college on Sunday. I used to be an addict to Coke. Coca-Cola, that is. I was addicted, let me tell you. Had to have at least two a day. Now, don't be judging me. And watch this. I had to have a replacement for that. So what a lot of folk in the body of Christ do is say, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that. You're going to hell, don't do that. Well, where's my replacement for that? Remember, sin is an inappropriate response to a legitimate need. And so I'm getting ready to set us up to where I'm going to begin to teach us the principle of God's word that tells you how to replace those things. So that's why I'm setting you up. Tell somebody, say, he's setting us up. Now watch this. Say, Christ is in me. Say, seed is in me. Say, salt is in me. Say, I must protect it at all costs. Now watch this. Say, holiness. Go with me to Matthew 5. Go back to Matthew 5. I want you to see this. And I'm through. Matthew 5. Am I helping anybody tonight? Matthew 5, go to verse 44. Now, there's a lot of teaching, and people teach about holiness, 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 holiness is right. But some folk don't understand precisely what holiness is. So a lot of people think, well, holiness is, well, you a woman with pants on? Ooh, that ain't holy. You got makeup on? Ooh, might not make it in the gate. Peter may send you back. Somebody know what I'm talking about. And people don't understand it. And you abnormally use what you don't understand, and to abnormally use something is to abuse it. And the Bible says the law is good if it's used lawfully. Okay, stay with me. Are you there? Matthew 5:44. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. Now, I don't know about you. You can be as spiritual as you want, but that requires some salt. You just talk bad about me and I'm just supposed to say, well, God bless you. Well, get my salt. Get my salt. That, watch this, you may be sons of your Father in heaven. What does that mean? You may be mature. Watch this. For he makes his sun rise on the evil one and the good. He sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who loved you, what reward have you? Tell somebody, say, this requires salt. A lot of salt. Like the whole big old blue thing. Don't even bother trying to put it in the shaker. Just. Tell somebody to say, Christ is being formed in me. And if you greet, or do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? It's amazing how many saints will walk past 17 people to go greet their brethren. They will ignore 50 folks standing over here. So, you guilty of it. So don't even. Tell somebody to say, here's the verse that messes a lot of saints up, though, because it says, therefore, you shall be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. People take that to mean, you got to be perfect. You can't be, no sin. One, and you may not make it. Some of y'all know I'm telling the truth. And that's what you thought. And a lot of people turn away from God because they have one or two, and they think that, oh, well, I missed it. I really did it this time. And God is saying, get on back in the house. You just need another salt injection. God says, I rejoice over the one lost sheep. The 99 are with me all the time. I'm excited about the one that's been gone from the house for a little while. That's why on Easter Sunday, you better get every lost sheep you know up in the house, because they need to get found. Tell somebody, say they got to get found. But so now watch this now. Let me take it home. So the Greek word for perfect there does not mean perfect in how we think of without blemish. Or without, well, watch this, or without defect. That ain't what it means. Because if it's true we'll never arrive, then how could I ever be without defect? Right. You got to understand the Greek word there. The Greek word is teloi. Watch this. It means complete. Not perfect, but and that means shalom.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Come on, connect to that.
Nothing missing, nothing broken, nothing lacking, all is well. Watch it. So to be like God, to be, he says, therefore you shall be perfect or complete, shalom. It does not mean what I deal with is shalom. It means I respond shalom to what I deal with. Meaning, I used to respond this way under Adam. But since I'm under new management now, and I've been reborn, since I've been born again, that means now I respond with peace. So you can act a fool with me all you want. God bless you. They can call you everything but a child of God. God bless you. They can say you're fired, and you'll say, you know what? I'm so glad God shut this door, because, baby, there's a big one over there. They can tell you, I'm leaving you and don't want to be with you. Thank you for not wasting any more time. Because I respond to be perfect or complete, it means I respond how God would respond. That's this. Go to Hebrews 12:14. Hebrews 12:14. I got 3 minutes. Hebrews 12:14. Y'all with me? Here we go. Hebrews 12:14. Am I helping anybody? So let me just break it real down, real simple. My salt changes the way I respond. So when the world's talking about everybody get mad, everybody be worried, because we respond, peace be still. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Our response is, oh, okay. My God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. You ought to get saved. So my God can supply your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. I ain't worried about nothing.
No thing am I worried about, because I'm complete, for my Father in heaven is complete. And so I may not get everything I want right now. That means the blessing's got to keep working. But I am complete because I got everything I need. I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread.
Hebrews 12:14. Watch this. Here it is. You ready for the juice? Here's the juice. Right there. Ready, read. Hebrews 12:14. Ready, read. Go. Stop. He says, be salt. But please understand. He says, God says, don't let that heat you up. And don't let that make you cold. I need y'all to get this. Don't let a situation in life mess you up so bad it makes you get so hot that you make decisions that you're going to regret the rest of your life. And don't let nobody, no thing, get you so messed up, it gets you so cold you fall away from God. This is holiness. This is holiness right here. Well, watch it. And holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. Well, watch this. Say holiness. Say it again. Say holiness. Holiness does not mean extinct. It means distinct. Watch this. God says, please understand, when he was dealing with the children of Israel, when he was dealing with them, he says to Abram, all right, we're going to have to institute circumcision. And this circumcision is going to be the difference between my people and everybody else. Say distinct. That one thing, if you didn't know anything else about them, was distinct, which made them holy. So, say, I am the righteousness of God. So, that means I deal with stuff in a distinct fashion. And that's holiness to God. Meaning, the reason I don't got all my stuff hanging out, it's because I'm distinct. Amen. The reason I don't worry is because I'm distinct. Everybody else worries. So if I worry like everybody else worries, then I'm not distinct, which means I'm not holy, which means no man shall see the Lord. What does that mean? I'll never see God do anything great in my life because I'm not distinct. I do everything the way everybody else does it. And that's what some of you need to understand here tonight. God has made you distinct. You cannot fit in to a crowd. You're supposed to be different. Stop trying to fit in with zeros, baby. You're a superhero. That's a little Memphis pimp language there. Doesn't somebody say distinct? Doesn't somebody say holy? He says, pursue peace with all people. He says, this is distinction and holiness without which no one will see the Lord. So what does that mean for a believer? That means if the world talks a certain way, I got to be distinct. If men in the world act a certain way, oh, man, you see Sheila. See, there go that, see? No, I don't do that. Oh, you holy ruler, holy ruler. Yes, I am distinct. And if Bishop lay hands, I may get on the floor and start ruling. If the world dresses a certain way, and this is why even with our young people, we deal with them, because it's not about, well, my identity and we the this generation. No, you need to be distinct. If you look like you're finna be locked up, chances are. So peace, I'm saying, you need to learn how to dress not for where you're at, but where you want to go. You understand? Because I'm holy. I'm distinct. Oh, she thinks she's too good to go eat with everybody else. Well, if y'all crazy, I'm distinct. Therefore, yes. Say, I'm distinct. It means I talk differently to people. I don't just show up and have diarrhea of the mouth. Because everybody does that. I'm distinct. So I know when to hush, Joseph. There's some stuff, when you tell folk, you'll find out whether you got armor bearers or pallbearers, because they immediately go into kill mode. He was just with me at the club 2 weeks ago talking about he's saved now. But I am. I'm distinct. I'm reborn. Christ is being formed in me. Well, I know her. She used to be, you know, Slick Sally. But Christ is being formed in me. So I don't care what you knew about me, BC. Because Christ being formed in me. And let me take it another further. I don't care what you know about me, AD, either. Because Christ is being formed in me. I did that when I was a baby. Can't charge me as an adult, but I was a child. You can't even charge me as an adult. And if you did try to put me up, since the Lord is my advocate, not guilty. Are you hearing this? Say, we are distinct. See, that's what holiness is all about. It means we respond differently, we do things differently, we talk differently, we act differently. People should be able to meet you without seeing your Final Harvest t-shirt, without seeing your Final Harvest chain, without seeing you, they should be able to meet you and say there's something salty about you. There's something distinct about you. And please understand, here's the thing about salt. They don't have to tell you none was put on your food. You just taste the difference. So, not just all churches aren't the same, come see why. All people aren't the same. Because let me tell you something. I'm through. I'm done. Here's the deal. When you become average, you become extinct because there is no distinction that gives you a reason to live. And that's why a lot of your dreams and visions got, you know, God's like, is that all you want? Is that all you want to do? And like, but God, you know, and God is like, I hasn't seen. The things I want to do for them and them that I love. And them that I love, I do it for my namesake. Let me just encourage you. See, there's some stuff in your life that you're like, you know what? I'm scared to do that because I don't want nobody to find out. But I, and God's like, shut up. Hush. Does somebody say hush? Somebody is calling your name. God says, I'm doing this for my namesake. And God says, I'm not doing this for you just to do it for you. I'm doing this because you got to demonstrate the blessing in the earth. And what's a blessing unless it's placed on a two-timing shyster like Jacob? You're not hearing what I'm saying. What's a blessing if it's not placed on a liar like Abraham? Oh, you didn't know he was a liar? He had a lying problem. And you know what? His son had a lying problem too. Matter of fact, he lied about the same thing. What's the blessing then? What are you trying to say, Bishop? I'm trying to say your stuff don't matter. Our issues and shortcomings, God says, I dealt with that. The blessing really doesn't have any effect if you've been perfect all your little life. And you ain't done nothing. Ain't had nothing happen. You just been serving God all your life and just been just righteous and holy all your life. And that's good if you've done that. Amen. I didn't. Anybody else but Bishop, you say, I didn't. Because remember what sin is. It is not just going against thou shalt not this, thou shalt not that. It is missing God's mark for your life. That's sin. It is a sin to breathe and not live. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Does somebody say it's time to live?
Thank you for tuning in to today's life-giving message. Harvest exists to change lives by leading people to totally love God, love people, and love life as one church in global locations. And if you have a testimony of how Harvest has changed your life, let us know on our website contact us page. We're able to continue to change lives because of the faithful giving of people just like you. And if you'd like to contribute to Harvest financially, you can do so today online at www.harvestcc.me. Remember to love God, love people, and love life.